From all those things, we are moving to a newer thing actually, right? So this has got nothing to do with cataract or retina. It's a new platform basically. Like, so how many of us will watch the movies in 2D when you have an option for watching the movie in 3D? Okay, so only two people. The rest will still watch. Okay, three. The rest will watch. I'll take it as. So how many will watch in 2D? Okay, so the rest of the people are not going to watch anything. Good. So it's for them actually, right? So this is a newer platform, the Ngeunity. So this is how we operate, whether it's cataract or a vitreoretinal surgery. This is how we operate. So the surgeon sits here and there is a microscope and you've got the eyepiece. And there is a side scope for the assistant to assist. And so everybody is concentrating. This is what we do. And your neck is flexed, your back is bent. So you've got a chance of getting your neck pain and back pain. So this newer system is basically what we are doing is what the company has done is basically the removal of this eyepiece. So they have removed the eyepiece here, right? So it has been replaced with a very high dynamic camera, three-dimensional camera. So this will form a nice, 3D image on a 55-inch screen. And the surgeon is going to be very relaxed and he's going to look at the screen and operate. Is this an endoscopic surgery? The answer is no, because I think many people are doing endoscopic surgery. The problem with endoscopic surgery is neither the surgeon sees anything nor the patient is going to see anything after the surgery, right? So in such conditions, only the endoscopic surgery is done. Because where the cornea is completely hazy, you'll be doing, and it is two-dimensional. When you're doing endoscopic surgery, it's two-dimensional, but whereas in the DAVA system, it's going to be a three-dimensional, right? So it's going to completely change the face. So that's what I've been telling. And the eyepiece is going to be replaced with a high dynamic camera. And this is how we are going to sit and operate. So there is no stress on your neck or your back. In fact, if there is an option for PAP in this, actually, next time we should. So in one corner, you can have some movie songs also playing along with the surgery if you're really bored. So this will be the setup. And the most important thing is everybody in the theater will have to wear a Polaroid glasses. Okay, I'll skip that. Yeah. So right from the surgeon to the assistant to the scrub nurse, in fact, whoever is there in the surgical theater will have to wear this Polaroid glasses. Without this, you'll not be seeing anything. It'll be a blurred image. So this is the one which is going to give a clear three-dimensional image. And the resolution which we are using is usually this is what we were, the CRT which we have been using earlier. Now in this, what we use is basically 4K technology. But when I asked them whether they can use 8K technology, they said as of now it's not possible because the screen which we are seeing should be ideally at around 100 to 120 centimeters away from the eye of the surgeon. But if you're going to use 8K technology, they said it should be much more closer. So it's not difficult. I mean, it's not possible. It's be difficult to watch. And so right now we are using 4K technology with the enhanced depth. So the another thing is, even if you are magnifying the image with this, right, there is no loss of resolution in this. The finer details are still made. So especially when we are peeling the ILM, previously we just see and feel and peel actually. Now we know what we are seeing and peeling, even the finest detail. So this is one of the most ideal thing where the entire screen of that 55 inch will be filled with the image what we are operating. And you can just see what you're going to. The finer details are so clearly visible. And this is for the VR people actually to visualize the vitreous better. We have this virtual filters where you can change the colors actually. So you can change the color of the filter so that while operating, you just go for the red free or blue so that the visualization of the vitreous is better. So we have got a virtual filters in this. Another important thing about this system is, if you see here, this is what the light setting we use, around roughly around 35% we use, because originally if you're going to use your eyepiece, the amount of light we use is somewhere around 80 to sometimes even 100%. And if you're going to operate inside the eye for more than many minutes will be operating, so there is every chance that you'll be having phototoxicity, especially if you're going to use indocyanine green. But with this system, actually, the maximum light we have used is 35% and the minimum is almost 5%. Actually, with that, the light source, you're able to see all the details so clear, actually. So the chances of the eye or the retina going in for the phototoxicity is very minimal in this system, actually. So this was, I think, not my video. Okay. Yes. Yeah, this was, you can imagine, this was operated with just 5% illumination, right? So if you are going to use 5% illumination with our microscope, with the analog microscope, it will be like operating with a candle light, actually. So, and another thing is now we have got the foot control, everything. Previously, we need one assistant, because to re-invert the image, you will get an inverted image on the screen. To re-invert, we'll have to use an assistant to go and change that. But with the new system, everything is in your foot control, actually, right? So you can re-invert, you can change the orientation of the camera. If you want to take snapshots, you can. What they have done is, this is basically from the Alcon company. So what they have done is they have made the Alcon vitrectomy machine, the Constellation, as the master, and the Ngeunity is the slave. In the sense, like whatever operations you want to do with Ngeunity can be operated with your Alcon Constellation system. So either you can do that, or you can ask your scrub nurse to change everything. So this is one of the advantages. The surgical ergonomics, as I have told, actually most of us will be having some back pain over a period of time, especially if we're going to operate for long hours, right? So this is what the data says. But in this, it's so comfortable that you can have your own position and your neck position to operate. And there is a better communication among all the people for the workflow. So these are some of the cases which we have operated with the Ngeunity system. Nothing great, actually. This is posterior vitreous detachment, which we do in the case of children, where usually the vitreous is densely adherent. So what we do is, under the PFCL, you just roll it with the tannos. Be careful if it's you ask the sister whether it's a new tannos, because if it's going to be new, use less force, and if it's old, use more force, and then roll it into a membrane and just peel it. So under the, what you call, the PFCL seeps under the induced PVD. Especially this is useful in case of children and cases like FEVR. So this seeps and you get a complete vitreous detachment. So when you get a complete vitreous detachment, posterior vitreous detachment case of an RD, then you feel elated, because there is every chance that it's going to be a successful surgery. And this, I think, currently we published it as a Megavis technique. This is named by one of the co-author, Dr. Jayant Kumar, as a Megavis. This is, I think, is a case of a giant retinal tear with the entire temporal retina folded over. So there is nothing great in this. The reason why we are presenting this video is, whatever your, it's, I mean, you can operate with the analog microscope, can be done with this without any issues. Okay, this is a quite a chronic giant retinal tear. So under the retina, you can see some pigmentary changes. You just remove them, then wash it off. After going inside with PFCL, settle the retina. The entire peripheral vitreous is, the base is dissected. And most of the time, we peel the ILM. In most of the RD cases, there is an evidence that if you peel the ILM, the chance of ERM forming is less. And that's not the only reason. Most of us peel the ILM because we can't peel it, actually. That's the only reason. And this is one of the cases. Now this machine has been approved by the FDA for anti-segment surgeon. Okay, this is a case of macular hole with retinal detachment. Light is not very adequate. And I think we are going to get the latest upgrade of your phaco machine in our vitrectomy system. Because the Constellation, when you change the cassette system, it is both an anterior as well as a posterior segment system. So we are using the combined cassette, where you can do the anterior and posterior thing. This is a macular hole with cataract, where the cataract surgery was done with the Ngeunity system. Previously, we had the problem of time lag, because the eye can tolerate up to 75 milliseconds, but now they have brought it to 60 milliseconds. So doing an anterior segment procedure like a cataract surgery is not a problem anymore. So like now we don't depend on the anterior segment surgeons to do our cataract surgery. It's done mostly by us, provided we are operating with this system. The only thing is, you'll have to change the cassette of your Constellation. So this is a case of a macular hole where you stain with the brilliant blue. Nothing great, actually. So we don't anymore follow this inverse flap technique, because the outcome of inverse flap technique compared to that of your conventional ILM peeling is the same, actually. Maybe the closure rate is higher, but the visual outcome is the same as per all the data produced now. Even the original innovator has not, he has abandoned, he has gone for the temporal flap, Dr. Navaroki. And this is a case of OD pit, where usually we use either the ILM plug or the scleral plug. You make a small scleral plug, keep it ready. Okay, so this is a case of OD pit where after the vitrectomy, we take just a 1 by 1 millimeter and one port is converted to 23 for the easy negotiation of the scleral. Plug into the vitreous cavity, just take it inside. Okay, many people just keep it, but I feel like just putting it into the, what do you call, OD pit. And once it is done, do the fluid air exchange and SF6 100% 2cc, that's what we use. Right, so this is a case of macular TRD. So the only mistake I am doing is actually we are so much used to the analog, like we are not using the exact magnification, the advantage of this. So if you fill the entire screen, this black area with this image, then the surgery becomes really easy. Okay, this is not a very tough membrane where you can just peel. Many people say that after the advent of this cutters, I don't use forceps, I don't use scissors. I tell them only one thing, because you don't use them because you have not operated the tough enough cases. So when you're operating tough enough cases, you have no option but to use all the what you call instruments you have. Okay, yes. So you can go for, this is a large macular hole where we are nowadays doing this autologous translocation of the thing. Actually under the PFCL, you just make a small infranasal retinotomy and bring the retinal graft to the macular hole and cover it. We have done microperimetry. Actually, the results of microperimetry is not that great, actually. See, when compared to the pre-op, the post-op microperimetry values are not that great. I think we'll just... Okay, so you can do a submact surgery also. This is a case of a PVR with a vitreous, PCV with a vitreous hemorrhage with a massive subyloid hemorrhage, where you induce the PVD with the help of your 44 gauge, injecting the BSS under the retina in four places. Just do a fluid air exchange. When the retina coalesces, do a peripheral retinectomy. Fold the retina. So under the retina, you can remove the, this is a membrane under the retina. You can remove the retina. And sometimes we go for even the RP transplantation also. Once it is done, it is treated like a giant retinal tear. Inject PFCL, do a peripheral lasers and inject with oil. And this is nothing great. Actually, it's a usual intraocular foreign body with a traumatic cataract where we have done a lensectomy. You can see a small foreign body sitting in flow temporally. So most of the time we induce PVD. Once it is done, then tease the foreign body with a MVR blade, and we use this rare earth magnet. Okay, this the foreign body is gently teased with the MVR and removed from the adhesion. And this is a rare earth magnet, intraocular magnet. With that, you just bring it. And most of the time, we use the electromagnet, which is much older than me in the department. I think this is the only instrument which is still functioning for the last 50 years properly. So it's a very powerful magnet. We couldn't get a replacement. So we just remove it and keep the lens in the sulcus and the laser and do it. Okay. So we have compared actually this in the macular hole, comparing the analog with this. The only difficulty we found is raising the flap in case of macular hole is slightly difficult in case of the macular hole surgeries. Otherwise, in Ngeunity, otherwise I think it is comparable. And if you ask what is the learning curve, the answer is going to be nothing. If you have the machine, you sit, you can learn it. Actually, it's nothing difficult, but one condition is there. Terms and conditions apply as usual. You can learn and you can do comfortably, provided you are 40 plus. Because the reason I am saying is you're going to sit in front of a TV at a 3 feet distance. When you're going to be young, if you're going to accommodate, it's going to cause a lot of eye strain. But for people beyond 40, it's a bit difficult. I get a lot of eye strain, by the way. You don't understand. Okay, so this is another publication this year in BJO where we used it for the high volumes. Most of this includes our fellows also. But the only thing is, because we use a high definition camera, the images are a bit unnatural. That's what the only complaint made by most of our fellows when the interview was done. Otherwise, they are also comfortable with this, right? This is the earlier, the submacular surgeries post-op, I think. So basically, the advantages of this system is it basically improves the posture and it reduces the fatigue. And because you're going to operate by seeing a 55 inch screen at 1 meter or 1.1 meter distance, it's going to increase the longevity of the operating surgeon. Because even if the surgeon is going to have 6/24 vision with a magnified view, I think the surgeon can still operate, right? So most important thing is the lower lights. At 25% or 35%, you get a very good image of the fundus. magnification is unbelievably fantastic. So you see what you are doing, and as I have told already, it extends the life of the VR surgeon. There is no learning curve absolutely, and the most important thing is the what you call teaching tool. You just put a Bluetooth headset to your fellow. Previously, will be sitting by the side, and in order to show that you are a big man, will be shouting in front of the patient actually. So now you, what you can do is you just sit 2-3 meters away, you just see what he is doing, and you can give command over the Bluetooth which he can listen to, so that the patient is not disturbed that is being subjected to training, right? There are certain disadvantages. The most important thing is accountability, in the sense whatever mistake you are going to do, everybody is going to watch. So you'll have to be very careful. You cannot say that, see, the retina is coming into the cutter. They will know whether you are going near the retina coming to the cutter, right? So we cannot hide our mistakes. As usual, the cost is very high. Now we have got one more company, I think, Zeiss has come out with their machine. Maybe shortly, Chinese might come with a cheaper version. And in future, our fellows and the upcoming VR surgeons might do something with the smartphone also. We'll wait for the day. And in case if the media is a bit hazy, I think it's a bit difficult to do the surgery. When you're magnifying, the superior image gets cut, actually, that's the only issue. The last one is no more a problem, the white balance. Because previously, we'll have to do the white balance once in 15 days. When we are operating, if the balance goes up, we'll have to change. Now, it's not a problem anymore. It has become totally automated. So, that's not an issue. So, this DAVS system, which is both for anterior as well as which has been now recently approved for your, what you call, the cataract surgery, is going to be the future, actually, especially for the teaching purpose, actually. And if they ask whether it is a must to have it, the answer I always give is, if you have got DAVS, it's good. If you don't have DAVS, it is even better actually, right? Whatever you can do with the DAVS, you can still do with analog or vice versa. This is another additional tool, that's it. If it's there, it's fine. If it's not there, it's not at all a problem, right? We can still carry on with our good VR.